Morning, everyone. Wart has asked me to talk a little bit about the African Register of Marine Species, which is called AFREMAS. Now, I cannot talk about just AFREMAS. I also have to mention WORMS, which is the World Register of Marine Species, and some other initiatives. This presentation is just to give you the general overview of what is AFREMAS and how is it linked to other initiatives. And then later on today and tomorrow, I will go more into detail on how you can use AFREMAS to validate your own data and how you can use it for quality control. So I'll first talk a little bit about WORMS, because that's the overall system. Then Malika already touched on some history, MASDEA and AFREMAS. I'll mention the data flows and the relationship between AFREMAS and AFROBIS, which is apparently not always very clear. Then something specifically on AFREMAS, and then some steps towards the future. Now, I'll start with WORMS. WORMS is the World Register of Marine Species, and what WORMS aims to do is to provide the most authoritative list of names of all marine species that were ever published. WORMS itself actually started in 2004 under a European project called MARBEF, which developed the European Register of Marine Species. So that was actually the first start developing or putting together a European species list, marine species list. And then only in 2007, ERMS, the European Register, developed further into a World Register. Now, WORMS is not just a name index, it's not just species names that are in there, but it's actually expert-based taxonomic database, which means that the content of the system, all the names, are checked by taxonomic editors. We have over 200 taxonomic editors which are active within WORMS, which means that they check the content that we currently have. Is a name valid or not? Is there a change in the status? Is it going from an accepted name to a synonym? Is it a homonym? How is it linked to other taxa? So these taxonomic editors are basically responsible for the quality of the information that we have within the system. WORMS is not just those 200 editors, but WORMS also has a steering committee of 12 members. They are chosen by election. The whole editor community can elect the steering committee. And the steering committee basically takes the day-to-day decisions that concern WORMS. An example could be that some of our editors or our users have a very specific question for a development or a new tool that could be used within the system. Then it's the steering committee that will evaluate that request and will see if we, yes or no, will do the development. WORMS is hosted right next door here in the Flanders Marine Institute. And this is a very big advantage of the system WORMS, that it has a permanent host institute. As you are all familiar with a lot of projects can set up databases or systems within their short duration, 3 to 5 or 6 years. But once the project is finished, it's sometimes hard to keep the database or the system that was developed alive, because people move to other jobs, move to other responsibilities. Now, WORMS does not have this. WORMS has a permanent host institute at FLIS and also has a permanent staff taking care of the technical and day-to-day data management issues of the system. WORMS is completely web-based. Everything that we have in WORMS is available online. Wherever you are, if you have access to the internet, you can go to WORMS and consult it. We also have a lot of web services, but I will get back to that tomorrow. WORMS is also following international standards, which is really important if you want to be an authoritative list. And we use, for example, the permanent global unique identifiers, which means that once we enter a name into the system, it gets a specific number or ID that does not change anymore. The status of the name can change, so it can go from accepted to unaccepted, but that ID linked to it remains the same, which makes it very easy for other systems to use that ID and to link back to us. Now, content-wise, very briefly, within WORMS, we have over 220,000 accepted species names. If we compare that to Afrimas, Afrimas has a little under 25,000. And the same for distributions. Worms has almost 375,000 distributions, while Afrimas has almost 82,000. This difference is very normal, because Afrimas is part of Worms. Afrimas cannot be as big as Worms, but this is just to give you an idea of how the two relate to each other. Now, both Worms and Afrimas also contain literature references, specimen information, like the holotype of a species, where is it, at what museum, and its specific distribution details. We can also have host-parasite relationships documented in the system. There's habitat information telling if your species is marine or marine and brackish, or maybe even freshwater. Information on feeding types. We also have a lot of images and notes. Notes can basically be anything that doesn't fit in the system structured-wise. So notes is a free text field. And mostly a note could be something like on the ecology of a species that might be important for a specific region. Now, what does worms look like? I'll start, if this works. There we go. So the worms database is global. So it covers the whole world and it covers all species groups. That is what the worms is offering. Now, this is hard. Here we go. Worms also has global species databases within it, which means that sometimes editors really want to have the focus on their own group. So we have developed separate websites that only show the sponges, or only show the polychaetes, or only the whales and the dolphins. Now, everything that you have within these global species databases is also in worms. It's just what we do is, if you have worms as a whole, we just take out a little section and show it on a separate website. But the information there is identical. Now, next to these global species databases, which focus on a specific taxonomic group, we also have regional species databases. Regional, it says it itself, it focuses on a specific region. So here we have Afrimas, we also have the European register, we have a Canadian register, an Antarctic register, and so on. Also, again, the same, everything that is within the regional register is also available within Worms. The only thing that we do is put a specific view on the information from that specific region. So next to global and regional, we also have thematic species databases. Two examples here are a list on the harmful algal blooms that we have. And recently, since a year and a half, I think, we also have a world register on deep sea species. So this entry, words, only shows the deep sea species. But again, the information that is shown there is also within worms. Is identical. So these three components are within worms. I'm really having difficulties here with this pointing. Okay. Here at the bottom, worms also links with a number of external databases, as we call them. And with external, we mean that I think you're all familiar with Fishbase. Everyone knows Fishbase. Fishbase is hosted and maintained in the Philippines, is also steered by taxonomic editors there locally. And what Worms does is just take the taxonomic information from Fishbase to also show it in Worms. So for Fishbase and for some others that I'm mentioning here, Worms is not doing anything. We only link to it and make the taxonomic information available within Worms, so it's easy for the community to search for information. Is this clear for everyone? This? Okay. Because that's an important slide, just to know how everything is structured. So I mentioned the regional species lists, and I'm just showing them now by name and on the map, so you can get an idea of what is covered. And since a couple of years, of course, we have Afrimas, which is all the blue, more or less. This is the region that is covered. this specific area is complicated in the sense that it's the Mediterranean Sea, and we have people in the Mediterranean Sea being very active. But Mediterranean Sea is also bordering Africa, so there we need to have a collaboration between the people in the Mediterranean Sea and the people in Africa. But we'll get back to that later too. So now something about the data management. So you also kind of have some background on how we work to get information into the system and how everything is structured. Now, before 2009, before we actually started with WORMS, when it was still ERMS, we had a limited number of experts being involved in the system. And additions to the system or information being added to the system could happen on all levels, which means that, for example, the data management here at FLIS could go through publications. If you find a new name, it's not yet in the system, we just entered it. The same thing happened during workshops and projects, like Malika already mentioned. We had a number of projects in the past, 2005 and 7, I think, were the ones where we had a small group of people here going through literature and just adding new species names and distributions to the system. And that also happened directly through online addition and edits. You just got a login to the system, you went online, and you entered some new information. The projects that were then available or working with the system were kind of limited. So we had the European Register, Antarctic Register, and some global species lists. Now, since 2009, we kind of changed the way we approach the system, in the sense that since 2009, the system is completely expert controlled, which means that if we have an expert available, then nobody else can enter that information, because that is the only way that the expert can keep control of what is happening within his group and on his page. So the expert also wants to know if other information like distribution or notes or specimen details are being uploaded. And that, of course, means that we almost have no more adding of information through the online interface by non-taxonomic experts. You can say, like, before 2009, you could have a new name, and 5 seconds later, you could have it in the system and make use of it. Now we have to deal with maybe 1 or 2 days delay, in the sense that now we have to send the name to the expert. He has to look at it. He has to say yes or no, and then we can add it to the system. Now, I do have to say that the taxonomic community or the editor community that we have is a really active one. So in most cases, if we ask questions or send them names, within a week, we have a good reply to how we have to deal with the name. So it's not that we are getting a backlog of months and months of work. That's not the case. But it is just a little bit slower than you having a name and putting it in the system right away. Why is this expert controlled? Also because we are dealing with over 100 smaller databases within WORMS that have to be maintained and of which the quality has to be assured. So the only way to do that is to work through a certain system, through a certain hierarchy of having taxonomic editors controlling the system. So just to give a comparison, the earlier workshops that were there, 2006, 2007, some of the people here were present there and know that we could just enter the names into the system. And starting from 2012, the workshop that we had in Tunisia, we started actually by the offline gathering of the information. Then we brought everything back to VLIS, to our experts. And I think even within 2 or 3 weeks after the workshop, 95% of the new information was available online. So Malika already touched on this too. We actually started with MASDEA, which focused on Eastern Africa. Wasn't limited to that, but that was the main core. And then only later on, it was decided to have an African register, which covered the whole of the African marine waters. So as mentioned, MASDEA was before 2009, so could still use the online interface, while starting with AFRIMAS, we're using Excel templates. Again, the not expert controlled versus the expert controlled information in adding the information. The same distribution information is actually the most important thing for Afrimas. We can only say that a species is an African species if we somehow or somewhere find a record that says this species was found in the Kenyan marine waters or was found in Angola along the coastline or something like that. Specimen information can also be added, and any other information. So what I mentioned before, that we have images, notes, distributions, vernaculars, all this information can be added to the system. The system can deal with this. On Mazdea, what we had before was a very limited options on how you could ask a question to the list. So it was just go through the list, search something, or ask for a species list. What we have now on Afrimas is a lot broader. So you can still browse, search, ask for a list, but you can also do a taxon match, which I will come back to later. There's also images, you can ask for statistics and so on. So it's more dynamic. Afrimas is more dynamic than what Mazdea used to be. Something on data flows, I promised. And this might help clear out some of the problems or questions that were asked earlier, like how do all the systems relate. I divided this in two big blocks, because what we do is make a distinction between the orange, is this still orange? Yeah. The left one, taxonomy, and the one on the right, which is distribution information. So this is actually the biggest difference between worms and OBIS. Worms focuses on taxonomy, gives information on the classification of your species and the validity of the names, while OBIS is a biogeographic system, and it just focuses on where do I find a certain species. So the relationship between the two is that worms, as a taxonomic register, is used as a taxonomic backbone for OBIS, the biogeographic system. So worms is used within OBIS or within the OBIS community for quality control. In a sense that if a data set gets added to OBIS, then the species list of that data set is matched against the World Register of Marine Species to check for spelling mistakes, to check for synonyms, or to check if that name is actually a true name, if it's a correct name. The other way around, so that's from worms to OBIS. The other way around, OBIS can also be used as an addition to worms, in the sense that sometimes within OBIS there might be species names that are not yet in worms, because worms is not complete yet. We are very much nearing completion, but there's always some groups or some species that might not be there. So OBIS might be a source for new names for worms. Now, this is on a global level here, if I talk about worms and OBIS. How does this relate? From worms, I said we have the regional register, Afrimas. So that's the same, it's the marine taxonomy for that specific geographical African region. Under OBIS, you have Afrobis, which Ursula is responsible for. So again, Afrimas can be used as your specific taxonomic backbone for Afrobis. I'll get back to that later, how you can do this. This is just giving the general picture. Now, Afrobis is providing information to OBIS, we know, but there's also other nodes there. For example, there's a Black Sea, a Mediterranean, and a European node, and they all provide their information to EuroBIS. From OBIS, which is the marine biogeography, there is a link or a data flow going to GBIF. GBIF is not only marine. GBIF is also global, but covers marine and non-marine environments. So everything from OBIS perfectly fits within GBIF, and that is how the data flows. Now, important here is, should I say, data exchange or a really close collaboration between, correct me if I'm wrong, Ursula, it's a close collaboration between Afrobis and EuroBIS, in the sense that EuroBIS is providing some support to Afrobis on the processing of new data and also on how to make the data available to OBIS. And this is something which is really good, having a collaboration between two different nodes, and which we might be able to take even further during the week, which we can discuss further. Okay, is this clear to everyone how Worms and Obis are? Yes?
I don't know if for Worms or for Affirmize all the information about the species, is the new species or
all species? All species, yes. Okay. So then, how do Afrimas and Afrovis can relate? Just a copy from the previous slides. Afrimas can be used as the taxonomic backbone for Afrovis, while Afrovis can help being a general geographic check on Afrimas, again, with the species names. So Afrimas is part of Worms, so is driven by taxonomic experts, while Afrobis, which is the biogeography, is driven by scientists, researchers, institutes having data sets that have distribution information. Those are the people that feed their information into Afrobis. Second difference is Afrimas is the general species list for the African region, while Afrobis has the distribution information on those marine taxa that were collected by, I'm saying here, African scientists and institutes, but Afrobis can also contain African data that were collected from people outside Africa. And a nice example here would be a very long collaboration that's already going on between Belgium and Kenya. And since that a lot of Belgian researchers went to Kenya in the past to do research, those data are now here in Belgium, collected by Belgian regions researchers, but because they are African, they will also feed into Afrobis. So that's the kind of collaboration that can happen. So Afrimas focuses on taxonomy and literature-based distribution, while Afrobis has a focus on the exact or the raw distribution information, where a latitude and a longitude is necessary or is mandatory. Maybe an example, Afrimas will have distributions which come from literature, in a sense that if you go to a publication or a book and it says species A was found in the Tunisian marine waters, then Afrimas will mention species A, Tunisia, EEZ, for example, exclusive economic zone. While Afrobis looks at where exactly was that species found. So that would be species A was found at this latitude, that longitude, on that specific date. That's the kind of information that feeds into Afrobis. So Afrimas can be used as a quality control check for the names that go into Afrobis, while Afrobis can be a quality check for locations. If Afrobis documents that a species was found in the Tunisian marine waters, but Afrimas does not have that information, then there should be a click somewhere by someone to check, is it true that it was really found in the Tunisian marine waters, and is that information missing in Afrimas? Or might it be that somehow, somewhere, a mistake happened and that species does not actually was observed in the Tunisian marine waters, maybe because it was a misidentification, as an example. That's the way the two systems can be used to quality control each other. Okay, and on Afrimas, what we can do in the future is provide maps that combine the literature information that we have together with the Afrobis or the Obis observations. So you have both layers on top of each other, which gives you a really visual check on how complete the both systems are. I've already mentioned a little bit about the editorial boards. So very quickly, Worms and the Global Species Lists have these taxonomic experts which can add, edit, and delete all information that is there. For the regional species lists, we actually need to look for local taxonomic experts that can collaborate with our global taxonomic experts. They do not have the rights to change taxonomic information, but but they do have rights to add or edit other information. They can change and add anything except the taxonomic level information. What we should do for AFRIMAS is get together a team of geographical experts, which can be assigned with what we know here within the group and together with our taxonomic experts, because they also know, like, if you want to look at that region for that group, then that is the person you need to contact. We need to have someone responsible for adding distribution information to AFRIMAS, and we also need someone responsible to check the quality of that distribution information, just to make sure that what we upload is correct information. Data accessibility is very simple. Everything is freely available through the online interface. You can just go online, see the information, use the information. You just need to acknowledge that you have used the system for specific information. So you have search options, you have download options, and so on. I will get back to that in the next presentation, actually, on how you use the system. So the data policy or the terms of use, as I said, it's freely available as long as you cite it. Won't go into details there. It's just you can use it as long as you acknowledge the source where you have retrieved your information. And there's also a disclaimer, and that's an important one. Although we do have an editorial board that manages the system, we do know that our system is still incomplete, and because of the vast amount of information that is in there, it's bound to have mistakes. No system is flawless. Every system has some kind of error in it. So it's important to realize that the board or the editors cannot be made responsible for any mistake that is still in the system. What you can do is if you find something that you say, like, this doesn't seem right, is just send us an email, point us to that possible mistake so it can be fixed. So this data accessibility is for Worms, but also goes for AFRIMAS. So AFRIMAS has the same data policy and data accessibility as Worms. And then briefly towards the future, both for Worms and AFRIMAS. So for Worms, very specific, as we want to complete our list as much as possible. We have, there is an estimation that there is about 230,000 accepted described marine species names. You saw the numbers that I gave at the beginning, 223,000. We're getting close, but we're not there yet. And we also have to take into account that the taxonomic community describes about 2,000 new species each year. So we also have to keep track of those, make sure that we document them. Now, I said Worms mostly focuses on the taxonomy of species, but what we do want to do, and this is actually work in progress, is to expand our content with more than just that taxonomy. And this is what we call the attributes or the ecological traits. For example, stating or documenting if a species belongs to the benthos or to the plankton. As a taxonomist, that might not seem very important, but for an ecologist, that makes a huge difference, being able to split your species list into benthic and planktonic species. Also, if a species is fossil, to document that fossil range, when in geological time was it found or did it appear? Also, documenting the protection status. For example, is a specific species part of the IUCN red list, and under which category does it fall? Is it nearing extinction, or is it... what's the other categories? Kind of lost here. But you know what I understand. There's different categories there, and we can document them. So all the relevant information that we would capture within those attributes will also be displayed on AFRIMAS. So this exercise does not have to be done twice. If we do it on the level of Worms, on the global level, then that information automatically flows through to AFRIMAS too and is shown there. But what might be important for AFRIMAS is to document the local status of a species. Because we know, for example, again, the red list, IUCN, is global. It says on a global scale whether a species is endangered or not, while the situation on a local scale might be different. So global, it might be endangered, but local within Africa or within one specific region within Africa, it might be very abundant and not have a specific status linked to that red list. And for Afrimas, of course, too, is to make that African register as complete as possible. What I tried last week, but I didn't find it actually, is to try to find how many marine species are within the African marine waters. I was looking for that because if we have some indication number, then we can also see how far we are going with our Afrimas list, how complete we are, or how much information we're still missing. So I looked at the African level, but I don't know, maybe on national or LME scale, there might be some figures, and that would be really good to know. So if someone would be able to help out with that, that would be great. And that's it. Are there any questions? Yes.
I have a question. I just want to follow up on what you said last. I mean, we don't know. There are so many areas in Africa that are totally understudied.
Mm-hmm.
And I mean, we know that taxonomists are sort of a dying species.
Yes, they are.
So how can one deal with that? I mean, there's a lot of field work that needs to be done, but mm-hmm. the experts to do them are normally not there where it needs to be done.
Yeah.
And are there any projects or anything I think it's sort of time to go back to the field to start filling the gaps. I think we identified a lot mm-hmm. of gaps and many different projects.
Yeah. Just pulling all those gaps together would be a really nice start. That's it. I mean, for Europe, we consulted experts, and the experts were kind of able to say, I'm expecting that amount of species for a specific group within a region. So, I don't know, maybe in Africa there's also people, not necessarily taxonomists, but maybe more ecologically formed people that might know, like if they go sampling at one location and they see the variety of species they have, and within the region they take a second location and again see the range of species, that they might be able to, how do they say that, it's an educated guess of how much species might be there. The previous workshops we had focused on specific groups. We had the mollusks, the sponges, and the decapods. Yeah, so just specifically going through literature on those three groups already made a vast expansion on what we now have available within Afrimas for those specific groups. So I think you kind of have to consider what would be really helpful here, and I think that does exist, is national species lists. They're not complete, but they were a very good start, because I'm pretty sure that if we pull together 5 or 6 national species lists, that I'm guessing at least 25% of those species will not yet be documented as being part of Africa. And I think maybe that would be a good starting point, next to having your actual data sets that you process, is to look at national species lists.
And then another question, how do you deal with misidentification of species? Because, I'm very new in this field, but I've done mm-hmm. my first survey, and just after this first survey, looking back at data sets from the same region,
mm-hmm.
Now, I've got a lot of question marks. I don't say these data sets are submitted or anything, but it's difficult because if I report the species.
Yeah. I think that's where the whole, I'll call it story of taxonomic quality control comes into play. And I'll actually be talking about that a lot tomorrow. But to be very brief, even our taxonomic editors within Worms are really struggling with misidentifications, and specifically how you have to document them, because the name that they use is a valid name, it's just they put it in the wrong place. Yes, so that makes it really hard sometimes too. And what you should be able to do then, but what is really hard, is once you know that it's a misidentification, is go back to your original source. The person who gave you the data should actually be pointed to the fact that he probably made a misidentification, so the whole system can be adapted to that correct name. No, go ahead. I think we have time. So.
Because it's something I've been working with worms and ovids a lot because mm-hmm. I started collecting data and seeing from the field guides that the names have changed and, you know, to try to at least have it up to date now.
Yes.
But not being a taxonomist, sometimes, well, my question is there a link from either worms or ovids to some other taxonomic guide? Say I've got algae now. And I know, you know, this is the name that I think it is.
Yes.
So I give it in and it all looks okay. But is there sort of a link that I could actually check if I've got my specimen?
Okay, yes, I know what you mean.
To the taxonomic identification guide. Not field guides that have a photo, but really a good description.
Yes.
So that I could double check my specimen.
That's a gap that we still have. And we're very much aware of that. But what we do try to do is mostly... if you go back to the original description of a species, you get a good idea of what the characteristics are that you need to pay attention to. So within worms, what we try to do now, what we try to motivate and promote amongst our editors, is that they document the reference of the original description. So that at least that reference, I mean, best case scenario is we go for the PDF and we make it all available, but it's already a good start to just have the reference of that original description. And that is what we try to do. A second thing that we are, but this is still very preliminary, they just started with that, is some editors are now focusing on identification guides, actually. So what they want to do is within the different groups, document the identification guides, but the good ones. Because you have different kinds, yeah. Because they have the knowledge. They know if you look at that group, then those three identification guides are the ones that are trustworthy, that you can use to distinguish between your different species. It's a work in progress. It's going to take us a while, but we do know that that is still a major gap. You have the taxonomy and you have the distribution, but somewhere in between you're missing the link with, am I sure that this is actually the correct specimen? Yes.